Zaragon here. I have assimilated more than 17,000 albums from around the world in my 35 years as a music connoisseur. To explore this journey in depth, see the Trimax Music Database on RYM and the Directory of English Bands on Jazz Rock Soul, both linked in the description below. While you're at it, hit the like and subscribe buttons and share the video. Today, we're going to examine the track Death on Two Legs, dedicated to, by Queen, from their 1975 album A Night at the Opera. Lyons down. Into, but anyway, yeah, that was Queen with Death on Two Legs, dedicated to the opening track from their 1975 fourth studio album, A Night at the Opera, their first of two albums back-to-back that were named after Marx Brothers, 1930s Marx Brothers movies. And Right here, I will announce the directory of English cue bands. It's a full directory of just every English cue band you could ever think of, and many that you haven't even heard of before, yet still great, still worth exploring. To see all the red hot tracks in the Queen discography, album by album, from the self-titled 1973 up through Innuendo, as well as by all the other UK cue bands like Quiet Sun, Quartz, Quintessence, The Quick, Quatermass, and quite a few others. And also see the playlist of all of my hard rock analysis videos, over 120 of them. You can see it in the card. Yeah, or just, dig through my channel playlists and such like that. And anyway, Death on Two Legs, it begins with this echoey fade-in and piano filigree just kind of beckons in with a descending root note that then rises, and then this sinister two-note guitar riff kicks in. It's like an octave A-flat. It's based in A-flat, but you're hearing like the higher A, like in a bar chord. And then dropping to the fifth E-flat, and then back up to the octave A-flat, and then it drops again, but to a diminished fifth, so D. So you're getting a tritone there. That's what's giving it that demented, creepy feel. Yeah, like do do no 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 no, like whirling siren sounds amid the smoky backdrop of that riff. Kind of that dark alley, grim reaper type feel and vibe right in that, in those moments. And then all that abruptly cuts to a stately piano figure in C minor that kind of had me momentarily thinking, this almost sounds like a precursor to the piano intro to Trick of the Tail that Genesis put out the following year. Although Trick of the Tail was actually written back in 1969 by Tony Banks. Yeah, coincidence. Just like at the beginning, did you hear me say that intro, that filigree intro at the beginning, had me thinking of the intro of The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway, the title track that came out the year beforehand? Yeah, so a bit of Genesis tie-in here, yeah. Genesis thematic crossover, even if unintentional, yeah. Okay, and then that piano intro descends as the full band commences. We hear some high fret bendy sustains from Brian May, some booming drums from Roger Taylor, that booming echoey, that embalmed production quality of Roy Thomas Baker. Yeah. And then the this choral flash just kind of fades in, fades out momentarily, ushering Mercury's intro vocal at 1 minute, 5 seconds into the track. And Mercury projecting a sassy macho swagger, delivering a biting broadside at Queen's former manager, Norman Sheffield. Referred to, if you ever wondered what that metaphorical title, Death on Two Legs, I thought it may have been kind of a metaphor for like a trouble woman, you know, or something, a woman who's spells trouble or something like that. Red lyrics, tricky syllable. Oh, yeah, I had to say, it was hard to kind of try and lip sync or act along to the song without really knowing the lyrics and how they fit the bars. It's not like an easy sing-along number, like Another One Bites the Dust or We Are the Champions, or like, because there's a lot of stops and starts. There's lots of abruptness. There are lots of syllables just kind of crammed into the bars, or like practiced in a way that, one of those songs where you have like some loaded lines where you had to find certain unique ways to fit them in and deliver it smoothly. And I'm pretty sure this took a lot of practice for Mercury to sing without getting tripped up at times. Yeah. And let's read the lyrics right now. You suck my blood like a leech, you break the law and you preach, screw my brain till it hurts, you've taken all my money and you want more, misguided old mule with your pig-headed rules, with your narrow-minded cronies who were fools of the first division. Death on two legs, you're tearing me apart. Death on two legs, you've never had a heart of your own. Killjoy, bad guy, big talking small fry, you're just an old barrow boy. Have you found a new toy to replace me? Can you face me? But now you can kiss my ass goodbye. Feel good? Are you satisfied? Do you feel like suicide? I think you should. Is your conscience all right? Does it plague you at night? Do you feel good? Feel good. Oh yeah, those lines were some of the choral overlayers were being employed. Do you you talk like a big business tycoon? You're just a hot air balloon, so no one gives you a damn. You're just an overgrown schoolboy. Let me tan your hide. A dog with disease, you're the king of the sleaze. Put your money where your mouth is, Mr. Know-All. Was the fin on your back part of the deal, shark? Huh. I'm trying to think, what made Norman Sheffield so certain that this was about him, even though he's not directly mentioned, and that there's a lot of metaphors going on? What made him so certain that, to the point where he sued them, and like some out-of-court settlement occurred, like back in the day, back when this album came out? Death on two legs, you're tearing me apart. Death on two legs, you never had a heart, you never did, of your own, right from, I'm not pretty sure many like non-Queen insiders would have had any idea who these lyrics were pointed at, or if they were pointed at anyone. In particular, insane, you should be put inside. You're a sewer rat decaying in a cesspool of pride. Should be made unemployed. They make yourself null and void. Make me feel good, I feel good. I'm wondering if just kind of like a couple word changes and that Norman Sheffield wouldn't have had any ground to sue the band on. Yeah. Anyway. The C minor drops. Oh yeah, one of the most jarring parts in the song proper is where the C minor of the verses drops to an abrupt A flat minor. Yeah, you go to usually it's got, yeah, where you go da 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 C minor C minor C minor A minor A minor. Yeah, that's usually go from C minor. If you're gonna pair a C and an A flat, you go from C minor to A flat major. That's usually how it works. And by contrast, if you're in C major, A minor is, you know, half a step above A flat is the relative minor of C. Yeah. Anyway, and then after the A flat minor drops to just G. Trademark multi-track operatic vocals at around 2 minutes in, delivering some choice, emphasizing some choice lines. A smoldering guitar break, thick, echoey pickup effects, that unique guitar that Brian May had custom made. An overall fussy structure with jarring. Okay, overall, the song overall, my final assessment. A fussy structure with jarring, abrupt key changes, lots of stop starts, interruptions, different, musical movements just kind of stitched together, crashing into one another. Like something that Queen would do from time to time, something that 10cc did a lot, even if they didn't really get into the heavier side usually like Queen do, the metallic side that's hinted at here. A musical reflection, those arrangements, of the frustration and damnation expressed in the lyrics. And for some light relief, the track cuts abruptly to the retro 20s cabaret of Lazy on a sunny Sunday afternoon. Yeah. Anyway, Death on Two Legs, dedicated to guess who? Yeah, the opening track of Queen's ultimate breakthrough album, their 1975 release, A Night at the Opera, although the prior two were just equally good in their own way. That representing kind of the period where Queen were just pouring so many ideas, not just into their albums, but into each song. Yeah, and this song, it's just kind of in a class of its own. It's almost, in some ways, through-composed. Yeah, it's hard to pin. It just doesn't have like an orthodox structure. That's part of the unique magic of it all. For more Rubies and Sapphires from the catalog of Queen, see the directory of albums by English Q bands to see all the Red Hot tracks and Purples by the Queen catalog. If you're new to Queen, queue up the red listed tracks, you know, make your own YouTube playlist, you know, play it passively a few times until the songs start to stick, and then play it more actively, find your favorites. If you really want to delve into the albums more, you know, queue up some of the Purples and then decide which albums you want to just go out and listen to from front to back from there. And like and subscribe, follow me on social media, share the video, and leave a comment if there are any observations you have about the track we just heard. The arrangement, the changes in it all, the different parts, and how it all worked and just crashed into one another. The lyrics and the metaphors and just the overall effect the track had on you, its intensity, its bite, and all that. And until next time, this is Zaragon, the world's most ear-traveled track maximalist, signing off.